This is a great conference for me because I'm used to not getting able to speak to an audience of nuclear people. So I think this will be a lot of fun. So I've been interested in nuclear science, I guess half my life, since I was 10 years old. So for the past 9 years or so, I've been doing nuclear science. And I guess when I got into nuclear science, there were kind of two parts to it. I realized that I really enjoyed it, and I was very passionate about it, and something about how immensely and densely powerful being able to manipulate the atom was. And then also that I was really good at it. So I enjoyed it, and I was good at it, and it's kind of taken on, and I've done a few things. So I started out building this fusion reactor, again, kind of in my garage, and I guess in 2008, when I was 14, I became the youngest person in history to produce nuclear fusion using this device. If it'll cue it up here, maybe. Oh, I don't know. I don't know if we're gonna get slides or not. But if they come up behind us, then we'll roll with it. If not, we'll keep talking. So, what is nuclear fusion? Maybe not. Oh, we'll start out with that photo. That's actually my garage. So that's, I think what I'm doing there is processing a little yellow cake. So I love to go out in the desert, mine up some uranium ore, mill it, produce uranium concentrate. So that's fun with me. So what is nuclear fusion? Because a lot of you guys in the room work in the nuclear power industry, use fission every day. So, you know, these very heavy, kind of unstable atoms, you plop in a neutron, the nucleus fissions, you get some energy release. Nuclear fusion, as I'm sure most of you know, is the opposite process. You're taking light atoms, say hydrogen atoms, you're slamming them together, squeezing them together, and they fuse together. And the difference in mass when you take hydrogen and make helium is turned to energy, and that is obviously an incredibly powerful process, just like fission. And that is the most powerful source of energy in the universe. In fact, you know, the energy that I'm talking to you guys today, that while it's been converted to chemical energy in my food or whatever, it originally came from a nuclear reaction inside a star. Of course, so did all the elements around us. That's a type 1a supernova, where you get, you know, the fusion stops and you get incredibly energetic nuclear reactions, high Z elements created. So all our elements that make us up, all our energy came from these kind of combining of atoms. And I think that is incredibly powerful. So I decided that, I wanted to build a nuclear fusion reactor. How hard could that be? And that's the inside of the reactor, which fuses together deuterium. It essentially replaces gravity and the large amounts of material you find in a star with what is an electrostatic potential well, or essentially you just use an electrical potential and you ionize deuterium, which is just heavy hydrogen, hydrogen with extra neutron. You strip off the electrons, it's ionized, and it wants to fall into this potential well, right? At very high voltage, say anywhere from 10 to 100,000 volts, and the atoms fuse together, and you take the hydrogen atoms, they form helium, and they give off neutrons and some energy. And it was those neutrons that actually I used in my research and developed from that point on a bunch of interesting technologies. I joke with people that, you know, I produced nuclear fusion, and then I wanted a challenge because, you know, nuclear fusion, that's great, not particularly novel. It didn't produce more power out than I put in. There's some fundamental limitations in the physics of this inertial confinement technique, or this inertial electrostatic confinement technique, that means that probably will never a reactor of that type produce more power out than you put in. But certainly those neutrons produced, you could do a lot of stuff with, and that's kind of what I set out to do. I decided that hopefully I could solve some really big problems using my brain and technology and everything else. So the first thing I developed, which in 2011 I ended up winning the Intel International Science and Engineering Fair for, was a system that detected nuclear material in, say, a cargo container. So, you know, nuclear terrorism, nuclear proliferation is a huge problem. It's certainly one of the remoter possibilities, but you know, we went 10 years in the former Soviet Union where we didn't account for nuclear material very well. So the stuff's certainly out there. We find trafficking incidents, and it would be great to have a net against nuclear terrorism, like we do for explosives and firearms and things in say airports. And so there's millions of these cargo containers coming in ports every year, and at least domestic US ports, even more internationally. And they're very big. If you want to smuggle in a nuclear weapon or nuclear material, that's how I would do it. And so anyway, these there are systems out there that currently can detect threats, gamma neutron detectors, et cetera, et cetera. But they're multi-million dollar systems. They're pretty expensive. And for that reason, and for a reason that I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with, which is a crisis in the supply of helium-3, these detectors aren't able to be deployed on a very large scale. And so what I developed was a detection system that essentially replaced the helium-3 with water, which there's a lot of other special ingredients in there, but the active detection medium is water instead of pressurized helium-3 gas, which we have a crisis in supply of. So anyway, essentially how they work is through the Cherenkov effect, which, if you're not familiar with that, is essentially I equate to like a sonic boom for light. So the speed of light's the cosmic speed limit, but if you're in a dielectric, if you're in a medium, the speed of light may be, say, 70 or 75% of that in a vacuum. And if you get charged particles traveling faster than the speed of light, they give off light, and you can detect that light as a function of incident radiation through various nuclear reactions where, say, you take a neutron coming in, you capture it on something that has a high neutron capture cross-section, it emits relativistic electrons, very high-energy electrons, and you detect the light as a function of incident radiation. That's essentially the basis how that, at least one part of the detection systems I developed that was so novel worked. And that was cool, and okay, that's great. Maybe we'll solve a problem of nuclear terrorism there. But then I moved on to the next thing. So actually, a picture of that one, I think. If we can bring the picture up. So very messy lab, but this is a prototype for the next thing that I developed, which was a system that actually produces medical isotopes, so the isotopes that are used in, say, a PET scan. But it produces them in the hospital, essentially at the bedside, with a device that is essentially mobile. It has a little bit more shielding on there than is present. But you know, the nuclear medicine is something that I'm sure you guys know a lot about, being a Canadian audience, having quite a bit of the world's supply of molybdenum-99 at any one time being produced up at Chalk River. And I would say the vast majority of nuclear medicine procedures use technetium-99m, the daughter of molybdenum-99. But you have this another class, which is PET imaging, which is incredibly powerful. You know, the nice thing about nuclear medicine is it's active molecular imaging. So the idea is that you can take an X-ray and see what's there, but with nuclear medicine, you can actually see what's going on. You can tag a biomarker, put it in the body, and see where it goes. So PET particularly is very powerful for this. You tag glucose, you look at areas of increased metabolic activity, so looking for cancer, and that's incredibly powerful in itself. And PET has a huge market, but it's a market that really hasn't fully been penetrated, if you will, simply because the PET isotopes are so short-lived. Say 109 minutes for the most common fluorine-18, although once we get these devices into production, we can start talking about shorter-lived isotopes that have things like nitrogen-13, oxygen-15, that have minute or so half-lives. The dose of the patient goes down dramatically. You can do different types of scans. And so I thought that that was a pretty cool technology. And about now, I'm thinking about graduating high school. So this is kind of where I'm at in the story. And I developed these technologies, and of course, you know, really big defense contractors and healthcare companies and everything else wanted to license the technology, but I kind of wanted to see my vision for the product, my vision for the commercialization, and so I decided that I would start up a company to commercialize the security products and the medical products and all these IP and patents and everything that I'd accumulated over the years, and that's kind of what I'm doing now, and that's where we've gotten at now. And that's going very well, and I enjoy doing that. At times, it's a little bit more business than science, and I fundamentally enjoy doing science. That's kind of my version of climbing a mountain, right? Pushing into the unknown, and I very much like doing that. But one of the big things that I've been doing as of late is research into power reactor design, which I'm sure a lot of you guys are in that side of the industry. And of course, you know, it's been an industry that we're, of course, since Fukushima, there's been lots of reassessment that's gone on of at least light water reactor technology, and you guys have your own domestic CANDU technology, which is interesting unto itself. But you know, nuclear power technology is great. It's incredibly safe, and the materials perform very, very well in their kind of standard operating range of temperature, pressure, and everything, right? But in the event of very severe accidents, very severe, breakdowns in materials management, et cetera, you can get a substantial release of radioactivity. And of course, that happened at Fukushima because you had an earthquake and inundation of water to tertiary backup systems, floating diesel generators, et cetera. But, you know, and for that reason, you know, nuclear power is very safe most of the time. In fact, pretty much all the time. But a lot of the cost comes into having to regulate a system that, at its extremes, is so unstable. And so I started to look at this. I started to look at the energy kind of markets and industry and thought, you know, how could we approach this problem of energy? So fusion is coming. I'm very optimistic about that. I think we will achieve fusion in my lifetime as far as commercial baseload power plants. Now, everyone may not agree with that, and fusion has definitely been the 30 years and always will be saga since really, you know, we went to develop the thermonuclear weapon. You know, it was only, less than a decade until we got a nuclear fission power after developing the atomic bomb. And they thought a similar development period after the development of thermonuclear weapons, we would achieve fusion, at least in you know, commercial quantities. And there have been, I won't make this a talk about the history of fusion, which is a story unto itself, but it has been a saga played with many instabilities. But I think we're getting there. But even if me or someone else were to break even tomorrow, which I know, I think there's some people from General Fusion maybe here in the crowd, which is a Canadian company, which is working on a magnetized target fusion approach. You know, even if we achieve nuclear fusion tomorrow, it would still probably be a decade when you look at materials, reliability, engineering, and all the things that go into actually taking a unity device, a device that produces more power out than the input, and making it into a commercial power plant. And so what can we do to fill those intervening years, at least for the market that I think fusion will take? And started to look at that and decided that there was interest out there and money to do it. And so now one of my big focuses has been the commercialization of a unique class, a new class of small modular reactor that is essentially based on a molten salt reactor design, which you hear a lot of people who are fans of thorium, for example, push, which I think CANDU reactors are a good one for that too. But essentially, this is a very specific design of reactor that can scale down sub-megawatt, but essentially, if you get smaller than 2 megawatts, the reactor doesn't get any smaller for your loss in power, and goes up to maybe 100 megawatts electric. And so that's kind of the design range of this reactor technology. And it very much fits into where, at least in the US and internationally too, we're going as an energy market, which is this distributed generation model. So why are we doing that? Well, a lot of reasons. So it's very inefficient to have large central generators and send it over long distances. You lose power to resistive heating and lines and whatnot, so you have to make more power than you actually end up using. That's one reason. National grids and grid have reliability issues. Terrorist attack, natural disasters, Superstorm Sandy showed what happened with those kind of issues. And renewables, if we're going to have a large contribution from renewables, we need to mix up the whole idea of a national grid with this more distributed generation model. And so while there are a few different sizes of these reactors based on kind of the same core technology, there's an 8-megawatt version, which is the military base, remote community, et cetera, version. And then there are 50-megawatt distributed generation version. This is all megawatt electric. And then 100-megawatt electric, which would be the utility class reactor. So you want a utility installation. You can put a couple of these together. You can do 100 megawatts electric, whatever like that. And what's really neat about the technology is that all the kind of fundamental materials issues, physics issues, and everything have been worked out. And what you're left with is a reactor that at the end of the day doesn't have an inclination in the event of an accident to release radioactivity into the environment. So you lose operators, you lose offsite power, et cetera, et cetera. The inclination, you still got some kind of dirty stuff in the core, but if it has no inclination to leave, then you've really solved to large part the safety problem of nuclear. Now, you reduce waste volume maybe a fifth or a tenth, and you still have some split nuclear fuel when you're left, but we're working on that too, so we'll see what happens with that. But so anyway, that's kind of a little bit of my story as far as what I've done and some of the things I'm working on, which hopefully this is a great crowd for me, and I don't have to gloss over anything because it's certainly an industry crowd, which is a lot of fun. And I'll one of the last things I'll say, that's what I wanted to do, is along with doing nuclear science, which is a lot of fun for me, I've always, since again 10 or 11 years old, taken a very keen interest in nuclear history. And in a way, all these things I've developed and all these technologies I've worked on and everything have been inspired by kind of, again, from like the time I was 10 or 11 years old, crawling through the cores of decommissioned sodium fast reactors, for example, and going out in the desert and prospecting for uranium. Here I'm looking for pieces of a nuclear weapon. The US Air Force just happened to let out the back of a bomber, which happened from time to time, the saga of the Cold War, right? And I've amassed a collection of these kind of things. But Canada has definitely had, I'm very interested, and it'll be interesting to talk. I've talked to many of you people and different companies and things going, operations going on here in Canada, and I think that it'll be incredibly interesting to hear more. Canada certainly has had a very unique nuclear history with very interesting indigenous technology, with heavy water reactors, with various other things. One of the interesting things among the things I do is go out and look for stuff out in the desert or wherever else. And the interesting story about Canada that always comes up is Cosmos 954, which happened, I guess, back in, was that the early 80s or late 70s? Someone may know a little bit better than me the specific date. But, this Russian oceanographic spy satellite didn't get ejected to its graveyard orbit and tumbled out of the sky over the Northwest Territories and spread radioactivity. And I think that that's kind of an example of the kind of things I go and look for, which, it's not great for you guys because you had a nuclear reactor raining down from the sky and pieces from it, but it's the kind of thing that I go and look for. And that trip's probably in my future to see if there's any debris left up there. But anyway, that's kind of my story, some of the things I've worked on, because it is definitely a very awesome group out there that I can throw it out there for questions. If you guys want to start hitting me with things, that should be great. Thank you.
Taylor Wilson. So ladies and gentlemen, if you do have questions for Taylor, we have lots of time for that. So just put up your hand and we'll get a microphone over to you. We've got a question here in the middle. Put up your hand nice and early. We'll get the microphone to you so that we can get to as many questions as possible, as quickly as possible. So let's start right in the middle here.
Go ahead. I have a tendency to go off on tangents, so just know if you ask a question, I'll probably end up somewhere different. But that's okay.
Sounds good to me. My name is Shayana Jones. I'm with the Deep River Science Academy, and what we try and do is actually encourage high school students in Canada to basically do what you're doing right now. So what I'd like to ask you, because you can see by the crowd, there's a lot of older faces here. Sure. When you were 10 years old, and no offense to anybody, when you were 10 years old, what was it that sparked your interest in nuclear and didn't give you that knee-jerk reaction? You grew up on the Simpsons. So what gave you that that passion to follow and be interested and not have that knee-jerk reaction that it's scary and I don't want to get involved?
That's speaking of growing up with the Simpsons, right? I mean, that's been a huge problem for our generation. And I've talked to some of the creators, so that's an interesting story. But anyway, how I got into nuclear science, and I should come up with a really fancy answer for this, and the honest truth is I don't know specifically what sparked that interest. You know, from pretty much all my life, I've been interested in science. That nuclear spark hit me when I was 10, but before that, you know, I did biotechnology or space science, which hopefully I'll end up getting to go back to with at least these very compact reactors for space applications. But anyway, you know, what specifically, you know, occurred to me that made me choose nuclear science? I don't know what that was, but I can tell you a little bit about how I got to where I was, and that is 100% support. You know, if I didn't have the support of my parents, if I didn't have the support of mentors and people who believed in what I was doing and got me the resources to succeed, I wouldn't be where I am today. And one of the things, and normally when I give a talk to at least a science, technology, engineering audience, and especially this audience in particular, that I would propose to you all, which is, interested young people, bring them to your offices, bring them through your labs, open up your labs. Okay, yeah, there's some radioactive stuff around and there's security and that's not always the easiest thing to do. But the more that you open up your passion, which for a lot of you, I know it's a passion, and that's why you're in it, that is how we get young people interested in science. It isn't reading a textbook, writing equations on a whiteboard. That all is great, but what inspires people and puts them into the career of science is when their passion is ignited, when they get excited about something. And you guys are all in a very good position, so I encourage you to do that, to make a proactive effort, or at least a responsive effort, to young people in your communities, because it's probably as much a selfish thing as it is me wanting to give back, which we all need a pipeline. And if we don't encourage the next generation, we're not going to have that pipeline of nuclear engineers, of engineer, you know, mechanical engineers, of scientists. And you know, we're going to be out of luck. So I very much encourage you guys to do that. And again, I go off on tangents. Hopefully that kind of stayed to where the question was.
So let's hear the Simpsons story. Since you brought it up.
Well, the Simpsons story. Well, I've certainly talked to them about that. You know, it's interesting that for me, so lots of people in my generation fear nuclear technology, radiation. You see the response to Fukushima with everyone kind of deathly afraid from radiation coming over from Japan. For me, it's always been, I don't know, I feel like I very intimately understand it. Now, I fear many things, you know, chemical hazards, whatever it be, but radiation, while I respect it very, very much, I think I understand at the point where I don't fear it, and it's, again, proof that we really do fear what we don't understand. And so, anyway, the Simpsons will interesting. We'll see if I get a guest spot as some kind of nuclear role on that show. Another question?
Nice. Okay, I think we had one back there somewhere. Was there a question in that area? Did someone have their hand up over there? Any other questions for Taylor?
I can just pontificate for a while and just start talking about things if there aren't questions.
Any advice to the industry in Canada?
Any advice to the industry in Canada? Well, I can talk about a few different things, if just kind of going off of that. Like I said, you know, Canada has a very awesome nuclear industry. As far as, you know, from uranium mining and milling, having an indigenous reactor technology like CANDU, and of course, you know, supplying the world's molybdenum 99 supply right now, which we'll see how much that lasts and what we can do to kind of combat that. But we were talking about small modular reactor technology, which is certainly something I'm very interested in, and I very much expect to have a technology and not too long reach market in that sector. But I think that you know, may be, and that people talk about that a lot in the industry is, you know, the nuclear renaissance is dead because of Fukushima, blah, 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 but small modular reactor technology, maybe it's saving grace. And I certainly think that small modular reactor technology has its place. I think it will be something that is very economically competitive when you talk about the economies of manufacturing versus the economies of scale, you know, building these large gigawatt scale plants, which are less modular, more modular. If you look at something made 20 years ago to the AP1000, you know, what are the differences there in kind of modularity of construction? But in fact, you know, something along those lines, and we were talking about down here, was water, because I live in Reno, Nevada now. We definitely rely on the snowpack of the Sierra Nevadas, us and California. It's been so dry, we're really worried about the summer. You guys haven't had to worry about that too much up here with all the snow, but you know, it's interesting. If you look back in history, there's always been a material that has driven both civilizations and conflict. And you go back, that was salt, that was ice, that was oil. Well, what's going to be kind of the coming resource? Well, I think it's water. So as the climate changes, we're not necessarily going to get less precipitation overall, certainly not, but where it precipitates changes. So civilization is built up around having sustainable places, sources of fresh water for agriculture, drinking water, et cetera. And as the climate changes, where those places are going to shift. Civilization's not necessarily going to follow that. So you look at these large population centers, and in fact, you know, with my power reactor technology, some of the biggest interest has come from places, for example, like the Arabian Peninsula, Yemen, Oman, UAE, where it's not like you're going to proliferate, you know, special nuclear material out of the core of these things. So you put them in places where they have their food deserts. I mean, you look at places like UAE, they may have a few days worth of water and maybe a week's worth of food at any one time. So if they have a geopolitical conflict where they're cut off from the outside world, they're kind of out of luck. And so they have a lot of seawater, and they very much need drinking water, and they very much would like to turn their food deserts into places of agriculture. So I think that the desalination market for nuclear technology, you know, produce power, cogen, or take the heat and run desalination units anyway, you know, separately if you're producing 20 or 50 megawatts, that's going to be huge. I mean, that's going to be very, very important. And, you know, there have been attempts in the past, and I've been to some of these facilities where they tried that. I mean, there's a fast reactor in Kazakhstan where they were actually doing desalination, but there's never really been a concerted effort to focus nuclear technology on desalination or cogeneration or whatever it may be. But anyway, yeah, I've been to all these kind of different reactor and reactor types, fast reactors, graphite moderated reactors, et cetera, et cetera. I have never been to a CANDU reactor, which I'm sure is in my future, and I'm sure you guys can help out with that. And one other thing I'll say is Canada has a national resource in tritium. Now, I think it's Darlington separates out tritium. Now, that's for it's a dose issue. You know, if you take the tritium out, your plant overall plant dose goes down tremendously. But tritium is very important. So helium-3, well, we have a helium-3 crisis. How do we get helium-3? Tritium decays into helium-3. The reason we don't have much helium-3 is because we've sucked it all dry and we're waiting for tritium to decay, and at least in the United States, we were looking at tritium production again, but Canada has a lot of it. And so helium-3 is important, but also tritium, because, you know, it really represents, you know, per gigabecquerel or per curie, the kind of cheapest radioisotope, if you will. And it's a beta emitter, you get some Bremsstrahlung, you get some low energy X-ray creation. But, you know, in a device, if you're going to do any kind of energy extraction or use of these beta particles, tritium's great because it is so inexpensive and because it is a weak beta emitter. So how has this been used in the past? Well, one thing that I've done a little bit of research on and been involved in is beta voltaics. So the idea, where, how does a solar panel work? Well, you have photoelectrons when the sun brings down its rays, and the idea to increase solar efficiency is you take in more of the spectrum, knocks off electrons, you produce power. Well, a beta voltaic cell essentially acts just like a solar cell, but instead of being needed to expose the light, you take the semiconductor material, say silicon, and you put a beta emitter in contact with it, krypton 85, tritium, et cetera. And unfortunately, this only produces for a typical cell, you know, a fraction of a watt, you know, not much power. And so in the past, the way these have been used is, for example, the Central Intelligence Agency has used them for clandestine monitoring stations. So we wanted to go over and spy on China, drop one of these things out of the plane, we collect environmental data, and you only need to do a burst transmission, say, every hour. So you charge up a capacitor, a battery, and do whatever you do. So it's not a lot of power. You can do certain things with it. But I think where the future lies in these small power units, or using a nuclear, what's called a nuclear battery, or a beta voltaic source, is very specific applications. So whereas instead of taking, say, I didn't have my cell phone in my pocket, but instead of taking the cell phone and replacing the lithium battery with a nuclear battery, which there's just not a lot of power there, you take individual subcomponents. So you run a specific, either a processor or part of the chip using, now because we're able to fabricate nanostructures, microscale structures, et cetera, the power density can be higher for specific components. So I think one of the interesting potential lies in that, being able to power specific components, say on a chip or in microfluidics using beta voltaic technology, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, that was a long tangent, but I definitely say that you guys have a strategic resource here and all that tritium that you're making as a byproduct of having heavy water reactors. So you should figure out how to sell that and make some money on it and change the world in the process. So,
I think we have a question over here.
Sure. How are we doing on time? I don't know what time it is.
We have another 5 minutes or so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Taylor, you are awesome.
Thank you.
Really.
Thank you.
So, and I think for everyone in the room, it really speaks to us. How are we encouraging young people to work in an industry, and how are we supporting them? Because
sure,
these are the kind of people we want. Not, of course, we don't want you also. a couple of things. It also speaks to me on why, how it's so important for the industry, if we're not doing it in our individual companies, and it
sure
is hard, to support programs like the Deep River Science Academy, like
yeah,
Let's Talk Energy, Let's Talk Science, the Girls Science Camps, Skills Work for Women, networking dinners, all those programs that are focused on working with youth and talking to them about the industry and about science. That is, I think, really important to support. So, and you are an example,
completely,
I think, of why, if we, that's a really easy way for our industry to support those organizations and get our word out.
Sure, completely.
But enough of my pontificating. I could go on forever, Taylor. But what I really want to say is, we're interested at our table. What do your parents do, and what do your grandparents do? And if maybe there was any, did they like science? How did this happen?
Yeah, there's no science really in the family. My dad, the family business has been Coca-Cola bottling, so soft drinks. And so there's not really a, going back, there might have been a civil engineer in the family or something. But my parents, they're not in science and technology, but they certainly were able to encourage me, get me the resources I needed to succeed. But also, you know, when I went to him and said, I want to build a nuclear reactor in the garage, most parents would probably said no. Admittedly, I'm a very safe person. That's like an intrinsic quality of my personality. So they had that to go on. But still, it's neutrons and radioactive material and everything else. So there was a certain leap of faith there. But I mean, without their support and without them getting the resources, without the internet and being able to build up contacts from all over the world and travel and those vast libraries of information available in the World Wide Web, I don't think what I would have done would have been possible. So where'd it come from? I don't know, I'm still looking. Just to elaborate just for a second on your point, you know, as far as public relations, communications, budgets, and everything go, I mean, outreach to students is not that expensive if we're just coming down to brass tacks. But it does build the pipeline. And so you do that in different places. You do that in, you know, K through 12, you know, middle school, high school level education. There's more in the nuclear industry in particular, there's more opportunities for graduate students than undergrads, for example. And undergrads are where, you know, if they weren't like me and they did it in elementary school or middle school, by undergrad is when they're starting to figure out a career. So personally, I think there should be a shift from, of course, you know, keep those graduate opportunities in place, postdocs and everything, shift it to undergrad. You know, do your outreach with bringing in tours of middle school, high school students, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, the actual active roles, internships, everything, shift that down from being postgrad and grad to junior, senior year, high school, and then undergrad and college. And by shifting that focus, you can get people when they're trying to find that passion, when they're trying to find something that they're going to enjoy going to work every day. And again, I'll say that I think we're in a room where people just kind of enjoy what they do. I mean, you're in the nuclear industry because either you think it has this vast potential to change the world like I do, or you enjoy doing it like I do. I think that you can inspire that passion by shifting the focus down a few years. And yeah, so any other questions?
Yeah, I think we have one more right here.
Okay.
So thank you for an excellent presentation. Okay. I do have one question for you that came to mind while I was listening to you. You're clearly in possession of nuclear substances. I'm not sure what all you have in your garage or whether they're below clearance levels.
Sure.
But I do wonder, what does the regulator do about you? Are they aware of you? Does the NRC visit you?
Yeah, I don't want to say they're weekly visits, but no, they come by every time. And, you know, essentially it comes down to, yeah, I mean, what I have, I don't have, well, officially, no. I don't have, you know, weapons-grade plutonium.
You're in Canada. You can say whatever,
yeah, exactly.
And it will never
this
get back to the United States.
He doesn't have to worry about it. But, no, I mean, I mill some small amounts of yellow cake. I have a lot of radioactive stuff around, but it's all, you know, very low activity, excellent quantity, generally licensed stuff. But you know, when the regulators have visited, you know, essentially what they say is I'm doing it better than most labs they actually regulate as far as safety. You go in my garage, I have glove boxes and storage wells for materials, which, you know, at the activity levels, probably a lot of the stuff isn't necessary, but it's kind of interesting that's kind of their opinion on it. I'm doing it safer than some of the people they regulate, at least with similar amounts of material. And so, I mean, there's certainly things I can't get away with, but there.
Okay, I think we had another question over here somewhere.
Same question.
Oh, okay. There's one more. Last question then.
Okay.
Like you, I'm American as well. One of the things we worry about in the U.S. is all the spent fuel.
Sure.
A lot of ideas, a lot of political ramifications.
Yeah.
Reprocessing for whatever reason is not an option. Mm. You're a fusion guy, but with all that fissionable material sitting around, have you been working on any ideas for all the spent fuel and possible options for that?
Sure. Well, I mean, the spent fuel, and again, if we start getting too technical here, I'm going to pontificate for a while, but spent fuel is definitely a problem. I've lived in Nevada for the last several years. I was supposed to become the first deep geological repository for civilian fuel, and politically, that became a quagmire. So, you know, here's the thing. Eventually, I think that reprocessing technology, so we look at Areva, we look at France, I think we're going to, for obvious reasons, end up where we're containerizing fission products, we're burning actinides, et cetera, but in the interim until things change, opinions change, technology change, et cetera, we're going to need deep geological repositories, and they work. And, you know, So Yucca Mountain, it became the most studied piece of geology in the world when they were doing the licensing process. And yeah, there were some issues, you know, over the very long term. And you have some things like technetium-99, iodine-129, very, very long-lived stuff you have to track over the long term. But for the most part, you know, deep geological repositories work. And we definitely want to make them accessible. So we want to put in spent fuel assemblies, be able to return to them after a while. But, you know, one of the interesting things is salt formations, right? There's been a lot of talk of deep geological repositories and salt formations. The first repository for similar stuff in the United States, Waste Isolation Pilot Plant, which I don't know if anybody's seen what's going on the last couple of weeks there, but it's pretty gnarly. They had a truck fire, and then they had, we think, maybe the ceiling collapse, so there's been some release of activity from the drums. There are two sets of waste that go into that Waste Isolation Pilot Plant: contact handled, remotely handled. Remotely handled is, I mean, it's not, well, not really, it's not supposed to be at least civilian spent nuclear fuel, but it's higher activity stuff, 100 R an hour on contact or greater, and then you have the remotely, the contact handled stuff, which is drums of, you know, smocks and gloves and everything, and that's what they think broke open. But independent of that minor issue that's been going on there, and I just think I need to mention it, I think that salt formations actually are great. There's some water, but for the most part, your salt traps things in very, very well. And so where is waste processing, waste handling going? Well, in the interim, we need deep geological repositories. I think eventually we will have reprocessing capability. I think you can do it well, and you can do it terribly. There, you know, for me, studying nuclear history, visiting all these sites to understand where we went wrong and right, reprocessing operations can either go really good or they can go really bad. When they go really bad, bad things happen. And if you don't manage them well, bad things can happen. So we'll get there. And you know, one of the neat things about this class of reactor I developed is, you know, it's made to be a sealed up for the operating life of the reactor unit. You bury in the ground. You have a power module you can take off and do maintenance. But for the most part, at least the reactor module stays sealed, which you can't do with turbo machinery. That's why you take the power module off. But at least with that class of reactor, you can burn pretty much whatever you want, whether you want to put in, we have a lot of weapons grade plutonium in the US, so if we need to burn that, you put it in. It's harder to fabricate, you know, MOX fuel. We've been trying to do that, and that's become another quagmire, trying to build a MOX fabrication facility in the US. But essentially, the cool thing about it is you put in your actinides, your curium, your americium, your plutonium, and I think we'll get there. So. What's going to happen in my lifetime? I don't know, but we need deep geological repositories, and I assume most people agree with me on that.
So, once again, ladies and gentlemen, Taylor Wilson.
Thank you, guys.